So let's talk about Common Core cut scores. And we've talked plenty about Common Core in the past, but not so much about the cut scores, right?
Right. So there's a lot of controversy and a lot of questions as far as what cut scores should be. The cut scores basically determine who passes or fails the Common Core test.
Whether a state decides to base its student proficiency tests on Common Core or something else, there's a different issue at the heart of how standardized tests are received by parents: cut scores. Simply put, this is the score on a test that defines what is passing and what is failing. While state-based No Child Left Behind tests were often criticized for being too easy, it's really the cut scores that ultimately define the percentage of kids who are deemed proficient in a subject. In yesterday's Washington Post, columnist Valerie Strauss wrote a long piece implying that the New York State Education Commissioner John King put the results before the pedagogy, picking one-third proficiency as the result he wanted, then reverse engineering test scores to produce that result. She explained that New York and Kentucky kids do about the same on the national NAEP test, but because of different cut scores, nearly 50% of all Kentucky's 3rd through 8th students pass reading, while only 31% did in New York. She asked rhetorically, are the kids in Kentucky smarter? Are their teachers better? Joy Pullman of the Heartland Institute and School Reform News, who is as far apart from Valerie Strauss on education issues as can be, agrees that the placement of the Common Core cut scores is purely subjective.
So I think what this incident is really doing is revealing that something that people think is objective, a test, you know, that's supposed to, it sounds impartial, that really isn't as impartial and as objective as we think it is. So what that means is that tests themselves can be manipulated. So that means we also want to be careful about using tests to be judging and rating everything under the sun, especially when there's consequences for things like funding and teacher jobs that come if somebody is pulling the strings, that means that you can manipulate the system.
If part of the appeal of Common Core is simply a harder to pass test, Illinois is looking to cushion the blow of the coming Common Core shock. The State Board of Education voted to raise the cut scores on its own reading and math tests last year in anticipation of the Common Core assessments to begin this fall. AIE scholar Michael McShane makes a different point. In the journal Education Next, he wrote that divergent cut points could undermine the whole movement. If the states are allowed to create their own tests and set the associated cut scores for proficiency or implement the standards as they best interpret them, any common element of Common Core will fade away.
Suddenly, Common Core is not so common after all if every state's making up its own proficiency cut rate, right?
Yeah, then that's right. And I mean, for some states, it's... my concern here in Wisconsin is that the state has found a way to game the system year after year up here. And Common Core, while obviously has its warts, was one way that after 2 decades of having a terrible test and very, very low, stagnant standards, things are going to be able to change and maybe get the state back on the right track. If you take a look at the state's NAEP scores, they've pretty much flatlined over the past decade plus.
Yeah, pardon my ignorance, where is Wisconsin in Common Core right now?
We are about to implement. Next year is basically going to be the first year with smarter, balanced testing, which right. is going to phase out the old, completely terrible, awful, crappy test, the WKCE. However, that's led to a huge debate this year. We've had 3 years after, or 3.5 years after the Common Core standards were originally passed, we've seen an uprising at the Capitol. A lot more people invested in this than any other educational issue in the state this year. Didn't actually go anywhere, but we really got to see where both administrators, teachers, and the general public were on this one.
Would you sum it up by saying the momentum is away from Common Core, but yes, it hasn't quite crossed the 51% threshold yet, so you still have it?
You know, it's really difficult to say where that is right now, because a lot of the people, a lot of the Tea Party people coming out, but I think one of the things that helped gain the public's support back to Common Core were the people that came out, the majority of the people that came out and testified in favor of instituting the standards and going on with business as planned were your teachers, your administrators, your principals. And I think that went a long way in not only convincing legislators that a repeal of Common Core wasn't in the books, but I think it also went a long way in convincing parents that, listen, what we have right now might not be perfect, but repealing it and rolling it back could make things even worse in a state that doesn't really have a strong history of creating and maintaining its own standards.
Yeah, well, that's been oftentimes the as you point out, that's been oftentimes used as the as the argument for Common Core, that states, when left to their own devices, have made things, you know, too easy on themselves. And you know, an example that I just gave in an interview earlier today was like, if it would be great for all of us to eat broccoli, Christian, three times a week, which would probably a nutritionist might say, we've looked at the American diet, and yes, it would on average improve the American diet if everyone ate broccoli three times a week. Mm-hmm. But does that mean you want a federal law saying that the federal government is insisting that we all eat broccoli three times a week, when in fact you might already be eating kale, you know, three times a week or five times a week or something. And of course, Chris is not. And so that's the difference. There's something that might actually technically be better for the average person if it was a law and made us all do it. There's kind of a freedom aspect to say, like, well, I'd rather kind of select my own diet. Thank you very much.
Right. And that's a pretty valid concern. Obviously, in a place like Wisconsin up here where we have choice schools that are going to be falling under Common Core, it's a big concern about making that uniform, one-size-fits-all brand of education that may strip away some of the uniqueness that the state had. I think the biggest concern right now, and one of the things that the state needs to look at in terms of a warning sign, is what's happening in Indiana, how they've struggled after repealing or making the decision to repeal Common Core, and how they may end up with even more standardized testing and a very similar group of standards to the Common Core state standards as a result.
What's the rule about voucher schools in Wisconsin with respect to state tests? Are they required to give kids a state test?
They are now. This year, there was a big push for accountability in all Wisconsin public schools or publicly funded schools. There was a push to shut down on bad, poor performing schools, chronically bad schools. There's a whole lot when it came down to actual sanctions and interventions. But what the state ended up getting instead this year was just a more comprehensive report card system. School report cards came in about 2 years ago. Going forward, I think starting in 15-16, they're going to include your voucher schools, your charter schools. Everyone's going to be graded on the same system. And that's a four-piece system based on growth.
And it'll apparently soon be a Common Core system.
It will. It'll all tie back to those smarter balance tests, yes.
Yep.
So
all right.
That's where we're going to get our metrics from.
All right.